Vita, Jack Daniels, Sonoma Cutrell Wines, Corbel, Tequila Herradura,
Finlandia, Pepsi, Aquafina, Bayou Rum, French Market Cold Brew, Louisiana Iced Tea, and festival merchandise, which helps pay for great entertainment, security, sanitation, recycling, EMS, and production costs. Please support your festival by purchasing from our beverage and merchandise booths. Do your part to keep the festival clean by using trash and recycling containers on site. And please enjoy responsibly. Special thanks to the Satchmo Legacy Stage contributors, Harris New Orleans, Joseph K. and Inez Eichenbaum Foundation, Ella Fitzgerald Charitable Foundation, the Fratell Foundation, Leslie Alley, Richie and Vicky Norigian, and Andrea DePlessis. And thank you to all our festival sponsors, including Chevron, Omni Royal Orleans, Abita Brewing Company, Brown-Forman, Fidelity Bank, GE Digital, WWL TV, Offbeat Magazine, NOLA.com, Times-Picayune, and many more. Be sure to visit our outdoor stages, the Abita Beer Garden, and our festival food vendors. Pick up a schedule for a full listing of all events, and stop by the merchandise tent to purchase the official Satchmo Summerfest poster, shirts, and souvenirs. Enjoy the 18th annual Satchmo Summerfest, presented by Chevron. And happy birthday, Louis Armstrong.
Happy birthday, Louis Armstrong. All right. My name is David Cunion. I've been your MC. I'm the music curator for the New Orleans Jazz Museum and the Louisiana State Museum. Thank you all for coming to the New Orleans Jazz Museum. Thank you for coming to the Satchmo Legacy Stage. We've got a couple of more of these to go, hitting into the home stretch, and two of my favorite people will be coming up after this. Gwen Tompkins is coming up to talk about Danny Barker and Louis Armstrong. And right now, we have professor of music at Tulane University and a really good friend of mine, Max Sakakeeny, who is going to talk about the mind of Louis Armstrong. So I present to you Professor Matt Sakakeeny.
All right, thank you, David. Great to see so many friends out there and back here. Andy running tech and David introducing me and friends out in the audience. That said, I'm hoping to have enough time for questions at the end of this. And, you know, friends don't need to hold back. You know, friends can hit me with those hard questions because this is a challenging subject. I tend to talk openly about race and racism, and I find that's not always the case in New Orleans in general and when we're talking about Louis Armstrong. I want to open that up a little bit more, and I'll start with an apology that I'm reading most of this because I'm working on an essay, which is another reason why I'm looking for your feedback. But the essay is about this question: is what went on in the mind of Louis Armstrong? And the answer is we will never know. All right, thank you. Have a good day. All right, appreciate it. And on the one hand, because, as I'll try to tease out a little bit, we really can't know what another person is truly thinking, and yet that hasn't stopped friends and critics of Armstrong from kind of playing a guessing game about his feelings. So for English trumpeter Humphrey Littleton, quote, "There was deep below the surface of companionship and bonhomie an impenetrable wall in which every stone was an enigma." It's describing his trumpet friend, Armstrong. Armstrong himself would say very often that he was there in the cause of happiness. And this smiling and jiving Armstrong led critics to worry over a kind of split, a discrepancy between what they saw between his inner self and how he presented himself to the public. So, my colleague, Kryn Gabbard, who comes down here to Satchmo Fest often, I don't think he's here this year, writes, "His mugging and laughing had little to do with the inner life of someone who could be brooding, stubborn, and outspoken." And for Kryn, this really comes through in the 1932 short film, Rhapsody in Black and Blue, which I'm sure is familiar to many of you here. And I'll play a little clip of this unsettling image of Armstrong. He's wearing a leopard skin Tarzan outfit while singing to an African king who's presiding over the court of Jazzmania, which is inexplicably filled with soap bubbles. Here's that movie I'm sure many of you have seen. Just a short clip of it. Quoting Corinne a little further, Armstrong mugs his way through vocal choruses, but when he puts his trumpet to his lips, he becomes a different man. I want to suggest that there's this diagnosis of schizophrenia that often gets applied to Armstrong, where his true existence comes through the trumpet, but then gives way to a mask, and that mask is often associated with his singing. You know, of course, he is acting in a movie. He's literally an actor in this movie. But he's also an actor in all of his performances, and critics have really struggled with this. So, for instance, on the eve of his French debut in 1934, jazz critic Hugh Panassier worried, quote, "When he first plays in our country, he will think he must bring the public the actor instead of the great creative musician." And in these accounts I've been quoting, this creativity, it's almost like we want it to arise from some authentic self, and we want that authentic self to take precedence over this fraudulent actor who's devised to meet audiences' expectations. And there's a dividing line here, I want to suggest, between trumpet playing and everything else, including singing. And while I set about critiquing this notion of a true self versus a fraud, this diagnosis of schizophrenia, I want to say first that it's absolutely pervasive in some of the greatest accounts of Armstrong, including Gary Giddens, another person who's here often, but I don't think here this year. He wrote a book called Satchmo in 1988, which really opened up Armstrong to serious inquiry by critics and scholars, or at least represented some new frontier that so many other great scholars have followed. And I take these claims seriously and don't want to deny the possibility that Armstrong wore a mask, but instead want to put that mask in context in a couple different ways. The first is that we all wear a mask, that, as Shakespeare said, all the world's a stage and all the men and women merely players. There's a famous book in sociology putting some sort of rigor behind that Shakespearean sonnet, whatever, no, passage from As You Like It. Irving Goffman's 1956 book, The Presentation of the Self in Everyday Life, and he basically concludes that every one of us controls the impression others have of us by changing our outward appearance and manners. So why then do we obsess over the way certain people present themselves? The second, like Armstrong, of course, the second note of caution I want to sound is that we can never lose sight of the fact that black performers in the Jim Crow era especially didn't have the liberties to be themselves, to speak openly without fear of retribution. Armstrong is sort of, he's like a prodigy at ameliorating racism, and he transformed the perceptions of black music and further of black people in this period in the early 20th century, and studies have tended to focus on the overcoming without fully taking into account what exactly he had to overcome and the limits that racism placed on his freedom of expression. for instance, and this is difficult stuff to dive into, but we've seen, of course, glimpses of it throughout the years in these presentations at Satchmo Fest. The press regularly described him in terms like this: a rubber mouth and consummately rhythmic American Negro who looks, behaves like an untrained gorilla. Yesterday, there was some more disconcerting quotes in Bjorn's presentation on the Swedish press when he first arrived there. These overt instances of racism, like associating African Americans with animals, point to the larger society that Armstrong operated within, where segregation and voter disenfranchisement were legal, where lynchings were common, and where the full rights of citizenship and even humanity weren't extended to them. There is researchers like Thomas Brothers, Dalton Anthony Jones, many people in this room who've brought this to the fore, and like I said, I want to do this as well through two different pathways. First, his trumpet playing, which I see as a kind of opening for recognition of black humanity, the grounds for the making of an individual against the codes that would deny him this opportunity. And second, his singing. This is much more fraught terrain, and I know we tend to valorize Armstrong every year at Satchmo Fest, but he's been subject to years and years of very harsh criticism, right? And some of that focused on his singing, where his status, I would say, as a fully realized subject is questioned, where he gets accused of wearing an inauthentic mask. In other words, I'll follow through on Kryn's analysis of Shine, which we saw, where Armstrong the entertainer pivots to Armstrong the artist in this trumpet and trumpet playing and singing. I realize it's a little bit esoteric. Some of the stuff that happens in this room is, you know. But if you follow through with me, I'll come back on solid ground at the end. That was kind of like the head, and now I'm going to take a couple solos, and then I'll come back to the head. Is that everyone with me? All right. Let's start with the trumpet. Before Armstrong, in the first couple decades of the 1900s, his predecessors developed these tricks with names like flutter-tonguing, fake fingering, passing cups, glasses, hats over the bell. These techniques were known as freak music, and the freakiness is in the uncanny ability of instrumentalists to mimic human and animal voices, right? We all know, you know, repertoire from the early jazz period, like Livery Stable Blues, Barnyard Blues, right? But those tricks pop up all over the early jazz period. Trumpeters outside of the, you know, Buddy Bolden, King Oliver, Chris Kelly tradition were completely blown away that the instrument itself could be manipulated in this way. And so this, if you look, is a 1923 book called The Novelty Coronetist by Louis Panico, a classical musician who's trying to describe the techniques to non-initiates. And he uses names like the baby and the horse neigh. And one reason why I'm bringing this up is because early jazz musicians were toying, I would argue, with dominant perceptions of African Americans associated with animals, with babies, with freaks, in hokum songs that carried associations with minstrelsy. So some of you might know this routine that Armstrong described of with his mentor King Oliver and Bill Johnson, a comedy routine where they would use mutes to mimic the cries of babies, and then Armstrong describes laughing along with it like everybody else. This point here that freaks, babies, animals are popular on the bandstand and on record when this new genre of black music is being presented for white consumption in the jazz age. And it's really, really telling, as many others who've studied Armstrong have pointed out, that Armstrong really doesn't use these stunts very often. He uses them very sparingly after stepping out on his own in the mid-1920s with the Hot Five and Hot Seven bands. He doesn't abandon the gimmicks and the bluesy tricks, the freak music, but to establish his singular artistry, he breaks from the pack. He retrofits those styles in ways that meet, I would argue, and I'll draw upon this literature a little bit, Eurocentric standards of art, which is made by authoritative individuals. I was talking to Andy, the production manager here, that this is, I think, the only conference that happens every year where we honor a popular musician and an African-American musician, right? In my world, that may happen with Beethoven, I think, but I think those people study him. They get together once a year. But how often does it happen for a popular musician and a black musician, right? How do we get here would be one question. I would argue that Armstrong cuts across, right? He's a genius to no matter what perspective you're looking at him as. He switched from the cornet to the trumpet because he preferred the clear, smooth tone and louder volume. And maybe most importantly, he transformed what was a music of collective improvisation into a platform for individual soloists to tell a story. So let me take, for instance, Big Butter and Eggman from 1926. The recording begins with the front line, you know, the trumpet playing the melody, the trombone kind of interjecting with lower pitched improvisations, and the clarinet playing this busy counter melody. You remember Vic Hobson's presentation from yesterday, he argued this comes out of a barbershop tradition, but the point being it's a group, collective improvisation and harmony that sounds like this. That's the New Orleans style, but then by the end, Armstrong takes command. So I realize this is sort of second nature to a lot of us, but he's taking command using the blowing space, the sparse background to sort of step out into the spotlight. Gunther Schuller wrote of the solo to Big Butter and Eggman, quote, "No composer, not even a Mozart or a Schubert, composed anything more natural and simply inspired." Musicologist Brian Harker breaks down this solo note by note, so I'm going to give a long quote from him. "The phrases interact like the lines of a particularly complex poetry, calling back and forth multifarious rhymes which vary in strength and structural prominence. The complexity of the rhyme scheme creates a mood of constant surprise, keeping the listener off balance, yet Armstrong takes care to complete unfinished business, tying together loose ends, bringing the passage to a satisfying conclusion. No gestures are superfluous, all have demonstrable origin and purpose." And in this book by Harker, he sort of meticulously documents how Armstrong transcends what he calls, in quotes, the communal origins of the New Orleans style, the collective style at the beginning of Big Butter and Eggman, to reach what he calls soloistic maturity at the end. And he sums up, "It was as if the New Orleans sound had been clothed in an immaculate tuxedo." Makes me a little, you know, it's like we can be on board with this, and then at the same time, I guess what I'm asking is, like, what's really going on here in that claim like that? If the imperative of jazz is for each musician to assert an individual improvisational voice, that begins with Armstrong, which is why we're all here, who established jazz as a platform for heroic soloists. This emphasis on individuality is in stark contrast to African-derived musical practices that stress participation and collectivity, such as the ring shout dances that happened a few blocks from here in Congo Square in the period of slavery, and that obviously provided the earliest foundation for jazz to emerge here in New Orleans. also of the joyful noises that heard in churches where everyone is invited to participate. And Armstrong himself, in the biography we just heard about a minute ago, claims that was his first musical experience, right? Is bouncing on his grandmother's knee and singing along in a Pentecostal church service. And jazz retained at its core a commitment to group participation through improvisation, but individual soloists took center stage. This is Ralph Ellison's famous analogy of jazz as a form of democracy. It derives from Armstrong's solos, Ellison's analysis, his kind of theory, where Armstrong rises above the musical conversation of the group. Ellison writes, "Each solo flight or improvisation represents, like the successive canvases of a painter, a definition of his identity as individual, as a member of the collective, and as a link in the chain of tradition." And when Ellison describes Armstrong specifically as the figure who, in this is from an Invisible Man, bends that military instrument into a beam of lyrical sound, what he's essentially saying is Armstrong's singularity separates him from musicians who are like interchangeable soldiers in a military band, right? I hope I'm not just restating the obvious conclusion that Armstrong broke the mold with his trumpet playing, but more that he's helped establish the very possibility that a black man could break the mold in 1924-25 and so on, that he could be a genius according to Western musicologists like Gunther Schuller or Brian Harker, and a folk hero to a black culture critic like Ralph Ellison. There's this great story from Taft Jordan, who was a black trumpeter from Norfolk, Virginia, who was a teenager, and Armstrong comes to Norfolk in 1929. Of course, it's the era of segregation, so Armstrong's playing for an entirely black audience, and Taft Jordan describes basically every trumpet player in town is right up front in front of Armstrong, who's just released this record, When You're Smiling. And what was so revolutionary about this record is at the end, Armstrong goes up an octave, which means he has to hit a high C, and people are like, what? And so they're all lined up because they think he can't do it. There's some kind of magical nature in the record, right? And when he plays it, note for note, when he goes on break, all the trumpet players basically interrogate him and ask to see his trumpet and look at his mouthpiece. And then Taft Jordan concludes this passage by saying, it was no trick horn. It was just the man, the difference of the man. Somewhat paradoxically, Armstrong's singing invited an entirely different set of associations. If trumpet playing was a pathway toward recognizing his humanity, the difference of the man, as Taft Jordan said, singing was part of the stage show Armstrong, for a lot of people at least, with his ever-present smile and his facial contortions, exaggerated gestures, bodily movements. Speaking of exaggerated gestures, constantly doing that. This is the Armstrong who opened every show singing the same theme song night after night, all the way through the lyrics about the darkies and the mammies, until the final flourishing chords and the good evening, everybody.
Dear old Southland, with this dreamy song, yeah, take me back where I belong, right in my mammy's arms. Good evening, everybody.
That was from the Goodyear Jazz Concert in 1962, but I know most of you know he started off with Sleepy Time Down South almost every concert he played. Not necessarily as controversial now, but this is a voice that at the time signaled trouble for some. Starting in the 1940s, his singing and his mugging on stage prompted a younger generation of bebop musicians to accuse him of tomming. So Dizzy Gillespie, for example, says to Downbeat magazine in 1949, Louis Armstrong is the plantation character that so many of us younger men resent. And I'm kind of pigeonholing Dizzy here. He actually comes around on Armstrong, and they live together in Corona and hang out. Of course, Dizzy himself was a ham. In this narrow telling, 3 years later in 1952, Dizzy records a parody of Armstrong's version of Confessin', where he scats in a sarcastic growl in a kind of trickster move that draws attention to Armstrong's vocal facade. I mean, it goes without saying that, like, we don't come out of the womb singing like Armstrong, right? He's purposefully creating that sound with his voice, right, that gravel. And Gillespie would sometimes enact this on stage, complete with a sambo grin and handkerchief, including in this 1970 performance at Newport Jazz Fest, which I think is at a tribute to Armstrong, if anyone wants to chime in on that. Here's a little short clip of Dizzy.
I'm confessing that I love you. Tell me that you love me too. I'm confessing that I need you.
Yeah. When Dizzy, he's pinching his vocal tract, right? And he's manipulating the airflow. And we hear that and we know it's Louis Armstrong, right? We don't need the visuals with the handkerchief and the grin. It's what we might call a voice print, like a fingerprint of sound. And that's because the originator, Armstrong, had crafted such a distinctive sound. These are quotes how critics described his voice over time. A wheelbarrow crunching up a gravel driveway, a cement mixer, oil on sandpaper, a horn wailing through gravel and fog. That's my favorite. For Gillespie, along with many of his contemporaries, Louis' tonal qualities and his performance techniques perpetuated stereotypes of blackface minstrelsy, right? That's the underbelly that's going on here. It's the vocal equivalent of a minstrel mask, of the grinning sambo. And as I said before, Dizzy came around. And I've come around, too, to where I started with Kringabard's diagnosis of schizophrenia, Armstrong's mugging and laughing that had little to do with his inner life of someone who could be brooding and stubborn, Panassier, who worried that Armstrong felt he must bring the public the actor instead of the great creative musician. What they're ultimately fretting over, I would say, is Armstrong's job. Within the tight corner that was available to black men in the so-called progressive era, he's playing this character. We don't know what's going on behind him, although, of course, we have lots of archival evidence of him off stage and backstage that I'll get to in a minute. But what I will argue, maybe somewhat controversially, and my colleague Dalton Anthony Jones is arguing something similar, is that he's kind of a salesman of joy. Right, this is how he gets across so many racial lines in this time when that's scarcely possible. So while critics decry his mask as inauthentic, they're bracketing off the context of racism that left this tiny crack where Armstrong might show his true self. In a critical essay by Dalton Anthony Jones, he argues that Armstrong, quote, his job was to create, to emote honestly, not to critique the commercial establishment that mediated his relationship with fans. And so if we don't necessarily always get a correspondence between his outward presentation and what we wonder what's going on inside, this is not some schizophrenia, some Freudian thing. this is an imposed break, right? Free will is not extended to him, so then how do we expect him to act freely? We don't know what Armstrong thought beneath the mask, but we could be more empathetic as to why he wore the mask. For this man who saw himself as always there in the cause of happiness, there were occasional flashes of someone deeply attuned to his own subjection. So once when pianist Errol Garner puts his head through Armstrong's dressing room and asks, "Hey, Pops, how's everything?" Armstrong responds, "White folks still in the lead." Right? The most telling story of Armstrong's overturning the mask is from September 17th, 1957, when he called President Eisenhower two-faced for not forcing the integration of Central High School in Little Rock, Arkansas. He says in this very famous report that I think went out on the AP wire, it's getting almost so bad a colored man hasn't got any country. And the story made national headlines with the explosive effect of an H-bomb, according to the leading black newspaper, the Chicago Defender. Like many eruptions of protest from the civil rights era, including Martin Luther King, Armstrong's words have come to be embraced as an act of unselfish bravery, but at the time he was roundly criticized by a pretty diverse set of contemporaries. Ricky Riccardi has excavated reams of negative press in response to Armstrong's blow up, and not surprisingly, these include racist screeds like one I'm about to read, and it's pretty rough, from a reader who sent in a letter to the editor of the Herald Journal in Spartanburg, South Carolina, about, quote, "one loudmouth Negro known as Satchmo Louis Armstrong, whose ancestors came to this country from the jungles of Africa." And excuse me while I read this. "Armstrong is indebted to the white race for all he has accomplished, and he owes a debt of gratitude to America for the privilege of sharing in the freedom and prosperity he enjoys in the United States." This is like textbook unapology for slavery. "It is the duty of the press and the officials of both national and state governments to join in the righteous indignation until such low specimens are brought before the bar of justice and forced to apologize to the American people or be given a one-way ticket to Africa where he belongs." Amen. Such overt racism can sometimes distract from more sympathetic views that nevertheless uphold a racial hierarchy. So an editor of the Muncie Star wrote, "For years we have cherished a deep admiration for this big jazz-talking man, but we wish Satchmo had stuck to his trumpet playing." Right? This is, I would say, also in part what even some sympathetic critics are just play your trumpet, man. All right? Armstrong's eruption uncovered the degree of suppression necessary to maintain his normally conciliatory image. And this is really amazing quotes that Ricky posted on his blog. "You can't smile through all that," Armstrong told another reporter of the violence directed at 9 teenage girls legally attending school, "so you know I'm not laughing today." More, Armstrong saw in the incident that he too could be reduced to racist categories created by white folks still in the lead. "Something snapped," he told a reporter. "Suddenly, I was just another Negro, scared to walk the street." So as I wind up here, if we go back to Humphrey Littleton's observation that Armstrong's true self was this impenetrable wall in which every stone was an enigma, that's a quote from him, or Kringabard's statement that Armstrong's laughing had little to do with the inner life of someone who could be brooding and stubborn, this moment where something snapped for Louis might tell us why, right? Why, in Panassier's language, he must bring the public, the actor. Because at any moment, this most celebrated of musicians could be denigrated, to use some of the terms that were thrown at him earlier, as a gorilla, as just another Negro. In those rare instances when he snaps, it's almost always about race and racism. And so I'll end with one last moment when he reflects on this paradox, his sort of position, from a 1964 profile not incidentally in Ebony magazine in 1964. I'll end with this quote from him. "You know, sometimes I sit around the house and think about all the places me and Lucille have been. You name the country and we've just about been there. We've been wined and dined by all sorts of royalty. We've had an audience with the Pope. We've even slept in Hitler's bed. But regardless of all that kind of stuff, I've got sense enough to know that I'm still Louis Armstrong, colored." And I'll end on that note. Thanks.
That's Sakakeeny, y'all. Did you want to take... We have...
Yeah.
I know we have about 10 minutes or so for comments and questions, if anyone Great. Cares to comment or question.
Great deal of irony that I'm sitting here born and raised in Spartanburg, South Carolina.
Oh, wow.
Where, with a Jewish last name, I was not allowed to be a member of the country club there. At least my father was not.
Mm.
I would tell you that when you go to a Presbyterian church and you're called Jew boy all week because your parents are of different religions, that you use humor. You use anything in the world to get rid of the pain. And so I don't think the man was mentally deranged at all. I think he did exactly what he had to do to cope with the realities that he faced. So no mysteries to me.
I know Randy's. One second.
I agree. That was an excellent talk. I want to just be certain I understood one thing where you were making the distinction with the artistry and the trumpet playing versus the mask with the singing. Is the singing, though, also a dichotomy in that there's the mask that you talked about, but still the artistry there, you know, his singing, the scat, all the innovation that he did.
Mm.
So even though he had to have the mask for all the reasons that you described, didn't he do that brilliantly even within the context of the artistry he had for the singing?
Yeah, didn't he? I think that's part of the trickiness of what's going on here is I'm sort of dealing in the domain of perception, right? And how he gets credited for what he gets credited for and how he gets discredited for what he gets discredited for. But I would actually say, and there's been great presentations on this over the years, so it's not making some bold claim, but something we'd never think about enough, which is that there's just no such thing as the lead singer without Louis Armstrong, right? Is that he, by taking center stage, not just with his trumpet, but with his voice, he, first of all, immediately makes the singer sort of mandatory, right? What's happening in jazz bands in the 20s and 30s, who are the band leaders, they're instrumentalists, Duke Ellington, Count Basie, Fletcher Henderson, right? And if there's a vocalist there, they're like ancillary to the main show, right? After Armstrong, it's mandatory, right? And after Armstrong also, it's mandatory that the singer has to do something different with the tune, right? You can no longer just get up on stage and be like, "Dinah, is there anyone finer," right? You have to put yourself into it. And one of the ways might be scatting, which is the most obvious way of improvising. But in addition to that, it's all of the, you know, not just changing the words or adding nonsense syllables, but all of the improvising, putting your personality, putting yourself into the tune. I joke to my students at Tulane, you know, when, you know, how you watch these shows like The Voice or American Idol, right? And someone gets up and they sing and the judges say like, "Oh, you need to put more of yourself in the song," right? And very often that's, frankly, these very hidden, coded practices from black gospel and soul and popular music, right? It's like, well, melisma and scat, and what do you mean put more of yourself in the tune? Well, you add all these notes. Well, that comes out of these black traditions that Louis Armstrong was a master of, right? So yeah, absolutely, I think that artistry is there in everything he does. And if you saw Vic's presentation yesterday, he almost doesn't distinguish between them, right? The vocal and the instrumental are all from the same source. Yeah.
I want to elaborate a little bit on the mask. I'm from the metropolitan area and was raised there, and I just made a pilgrimage to the continent. I went to Senegal.
Oh, wow.
And everybody there, it was all this beauty and smile. All these amazing faces of the same faces that I see when I see Louis Armstrong. And the masks there are actually masks that are scary to ward off negative energy or things that are not for you. And here in this country, it's funny because it's not really a mask. It's really the true essence of an African-American person. But I think the perception here is like, how can you be so happy with what is happening to you? But you can't take the authentic spirit from what's there, and you have to question it because it can't be real. There's no way this person can carry that air about them with this kind of tragedy that happens to them. But what I know about the spirit of humanity and all of us coming from this diaspora, all of us in this room coming from this diaspora, is that is who we really are. That magic of beauty and happiness. And we don't really have to question it, but because we live in this society, we do. And I think that's something it'd be interesting to elaborate on.
Oh, yeah. I think, although I would say you did it beautifully, more beautifully than I could, you elaborated on it. I would just go a little further, by saying, you know, that joy is not just some innocuous thing, right? That bringing joy and pleasure to people and experiencing that yourself, I think, especially talking about African Americans and African American music, right? And you, that's not something that's just either a facade or an unimportant, you know, thing, but it's actually an act of humanity, like you said. Yeah.
Thank you.
So Randy's had his hand up for a while.
One way to deal with Parnassier's distinction between actor and artist is to take jazz back to its beginnings, where it was dance music, it was entertainment, and it's a distinction without a difference in that context.
Yeah, yeah. And there's these, Armstrong comes up in the vaudeville and minstrel era, and he's a huge fan of Burt Williams, and he has these childhood memories of the first time he, and I don't know the story particularly well, it's intimidating to stand up at Sashimo Fest sometimes, because it's like, maybe I'm not getting this exactly right. But the first time he really takes, not just participates in church, but sort of comes up into the pulpit area, he actually tells a comedy routine that he's learned, I think, from Williams and Walker or something. He's a huge fan of Bilbo Jangles Robinson, you know, the great tap dancer of the period. He does not see it as a problem that he's an entertainer. And I guess in part what I'm getting into with the stuff with Dizzy Gillespie and Miles Davis and others who respected him but saw themselves as different is that in some sense Armstrong kind of opens up the door, and then a later generation of musicians can walk through and say, well, we don't want to do that smile and jive and entertainment. But if he hadn't opened up that door as an entertainer, who knows, you know, what would have been possible by the 1940s, which is also, of course, the beginnings of the civil rights era and all of that. Yeah, but the functionality of the music as dance music, as entertainment, is his bread and butter, right?
Big butter and Agnes.
Oh.
Can you talk a little bit about Lewis and his relationship to children and the doors that he opened for that younger generation, the real Lewis? You know, obviously I don't know him, but I see it in the photographs from Corona. Mm-hmm. Right. And that when you talk about joy, that was uninhibited, pure joy, where he could let these children know that there was opportunity for them in the next generation that he didn't have.
Mm. Right. And I think in his neighborhood, black and white kids, right? I don't know how to answer that except to say that I feel like it's still true today, is that I'm on the board of a great local music organization called Roots of Music, and it's middle school kids who play in a marching band, and their founder and teacher is Derek Tabb, who's the snare drummer of the Rebirth Brass Band. And part of the success of the program is they, as kids, see him traveling all over the world, winning a Grammy Award, being successful, coming from the same, literally the same place that he did, you know, in the Treme neighborhood and in Bell Junior High and all of that. And so I don't know if I can think specifically about Armstrong, but that I think that's, as you said, in terms of the racist comment from Spartanburg, South Carolina, these conditions are still ongoing, right? And individuals are still stepping up and being role models in some way. And the only other thing that comes to mind, I should probably stop, is it does amaze me that Armstrong is like kind of standard K-12 curricula for teaching America, right? It's like there's children's books, there's classroom lesson plans if you go online that use his story as a way to teach young people in some sense of maybe the, I'll say, unrealized possibilities of America, right, and democracy, right? And that the thing about the Roots of Music and Derek Tabb is, unfortunately, we still, that's not been resolved yet, right? Okay, cool. Well, thank you all again.
That's Sakakeeny, y'all. One more time, that's Sakakeeny. We're going to switch up the stage. I assume if people want to continue this conversation, which we should now and in general far forward, we can all, you know, talk about it in the hallway and stuff like that if this wants to go on. But right now, we got to switch up the stage. Gwen Tompkins is going to come up next and talk about the relationship between really two of my heroes, Danny Barker and Louis Armstrong. So come back in about 15 minutes for that.